What is a great life? I mean, a truly great one. Is it true that each of us has what it takes? Can greatness be defined unequivocally? Let me introduce a person who had the audacity to claim at his deathbed that he had lived a wonderful life. It is the 20th century Austrian philosopher, Ludwig Wittgenstein. Ludwig Wittgenstein was born in Vienna, Austria on April 26, 1889. He was the youngest of 8 children. His mother, Leopoldine Wittgenstein, was a pianist, and his father, Karl Wittgenstein, was a world-renowned magnate in the steel industry. Obviously, Wittgenstein's family was tremendously wealthy. Gustav Klimt used to visit their house to draw a portrait of his sister Margaret, and great composers such as Johannes Brahms and Gustav Mahler piano in their living room. And they were not just filthy rich, the children were incredibly gifted. He has 7 older siblings, and all of them had tremendous gifts in art. All considered geniuses. According to Wittgenstein, he was the dumbest of all of them. Suffering from an inferiority complex, Wittgenstein followed his father's orders and enrolled in Linz-Realschule, a type of trade school for secondary school students. The idea was that, being talentless and plain, he should simply apply himself to learning practical skills. Wittgenstein ended up at the University of Manchester, where he studied aeromechanics. While staying at the university, he enjoyed aviation experiments, immersing himself in researches in jet engines and propellers. It is known that his work has led to new developments in helicopters used in the Second World War. Considering the fact that he was the dumbest one in the family, you can only imagine what his brothers and sisters would have been capable of had they studied aeromechanics. However, while studying engineering, he became interested in pure mathematics and eventually found himself drawn towards philosophy. Through a colleague, he was introduced to Gottlob Frege and Bertrand Russell, who were considered to be the giants of mathematics and philosophy at the time. Having discovered a world that seemed even more fascinating than that of engineering, Wittgenstein jumped headfirst into the world of philosophy. In 1911, Wittgenstein headed to Cambridge in order to meet Russell. Right away, Wittgenstein began to argue with Russell on various philosophical issues. He asked Russell, "Do you think I have what it takes to become a philosopher?" Russell was known to have responded, "Well, write something for me then." Having read what Wittgenstein had written, Russell became convinced that Wittgenstein will achieve greatness in philosophy. He exclaimed, "Wittgenstein is my dreamy self." In 1913, Wittgenstein left Cambridge for Norway to study logic by himself. It is there that he began his work on a text that would eventually become Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus. In 1914, with the outbreak of the First World War, Wittgenstein volunteered himself for the Austrian army. During the war, he stumbled upon Tolstoy's The Gospel in Brief and read the book over and over again until the copy was threadbare. He hoped that God would come and save his tortured soul. He'd also read Otto Weininger and Arthur Schopenhauer along with Dostoevsky. By reading this text thoroughly, he searched for a way to carry out his life's work whilst leading an ethical and blameless life. That was the pinnacle of existence Wittgenstein was looking for. As Wittgenstein faced the opposing army for the first time, he wrote in his diary, "Now I should have the chance to be a decent human being, for I'm standing eye to eye with death." When he was finally stationed at the front lines, he would pray that, "If only I may be allowed to risk my life in some difficult assignment," because that was his idea of living in the most earnest way possible. Even after being captured and placed in the prisoners of war camp, he did not let go of this quest to be a decent human being. So he devoted himself to the most worthy pursuit he knew, completing the philosophical system of thought that would put an end to the age-old tradition of Western philosophy. In the midst of fierce battles, standing face to face with his own death, he completed the famous, or infamous, Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus. At the completion of this text, Wittgenstein declared that he had solved all the essential problems of philosophy, meaning that he had brought about the end of philosophy. "Say what you can with the utmost rigor, and of the things that you cannot speak about, you must stay silent." This is the main thesis of his great philosophical work. Details of the content of this text will be dealt with in the next episode. In 1919, Wittgenstein gave up his inheritance from his father to his siblings and struggling artists. He claimed that the money would interfere with his work. Then he sought refuge in a small village called Trattenbach in the mountainous region south of Vienna. It was in this mountain village that he would make another attempt at finding the ultimate meaning of life, this time as a schoolteacher. Wittgenstein wanted to get to the essence of existence, and he would try to carry this out through working with children of elementary school. He would ask the children, "Do you guys know what philosophy is? Don't you guys want to know?" He loved his students dearly. He would try to find ways to allow the children to continue their studies after elementary school, instead of being sent to factories like many of their peers. Together with his students, he made a dictionary for elementary school children and would walk over 20 kilometers to buy them bananas and oranges. However, he lacked the patience necessary to properly understand and guide the children and their parents, and his attempt to understand the world through the eyes of children ultimately ended in failure. In April 1926, Wittgenstein quit his job as a school teacher and started working as a gardener in a monastery. Through rigorous physical labor, he was hoping to find the meaning of existence that was pure and uncorrupted. But while working as a gardener, he received the word from his sister Margaret that she wanted him to design a new house. With the help of his friend from the Artillery Officers Academy, Paul Engelmann, he began to build his sister's house. Paul Engelmann was a disciple of Adolf Loos, the world-famous architect who claimed ornament is sin. Wittgenstein wished to make a house for his sister that had the perfect proportions. For 2 years, he was Jude vigorously applied himself to the project, working tirelessly. For him, everything had to do with proportions. Architecture had to be like mathematics, precise and completely free of error. One of the workers asked him, "Tell me, does a millimeter here or there really matter so much to you?" Wittgenstein yelled, "Yes!" before the man had even finished speaking. In 1970, this house became designated as an Austrian cultural property, renamed as House Wittgenstein. Failing to sufficiently clarify the meaning of existence during his time as a teacher, gardener, and architect, Wittgenstein returned to Cambridge in January 1929. Upon his return, the economist Keynes, famous for his association with the New Deal, exclaimed, "Look, God has arrived." However, Wittgenstein knew that he was no God, and that his Tractatus had some logical weaknesses. He wrote another text on philosophy to right his wrongs. He bought 18 notebooks of 300 pages. It was his way of coping with his own life now that the war was over. As he was settling into his life as a professor, the World War II broke out in 1939. Wittgenstein, in his 50s, still wanted to fight in the war, but was too old to be stationed in the front lines. So instead, Wittgenstein volunteered to work as a porter at Guy's Hospital in London. He claimed that saving lives is just as great a calling as that of philosophy. You can say that what he really wanted to do was to step closer to the other, which for him was the world itself. This was the goal of his philosophy after all. The trace of his efforts is the Philosophical Investigations, published posthumously. This text will also be dealt with in the next episode. Just like the fate of those who attempted to prove God's existence through logic, he knew that his new project would fail. One could say that he knew he was going to fail as an elementary school teacher, gardener, architect, and philosopher. However, in spite of that, he wanted to get to the end of the road that he had chosen for himself. After the war, he spent the remainder of his life in a little lonely hut by a precipice in Norway, together with the other that he wanted to embrace. In 1951, with his health deteriorating, he returned to Cambridge, and in the morning of April 29th, 1951, while working on a short text called Uncertainty, he bid his last farewell to the world. His last words were, "Tell him I had a wonderful life." Wittgenstein always chose the road untraveled, and even amidst failure and despair, fought through life's struggles with defiance. In search of the life that he aspired to, Wittgenstein discovered his own path, declared it to be his own, and tried to see it to its end. He made his life seem like a miracle. He never stopped his search for the meaning of life, and at the end of decades of uncompromising struggle, he was finally able to tell his friends at his deathbed that he had lived a wonderful life. This was the life of Ludwig Wittgenstein. Everyone said he was born a genius, but he thought each of us has what it takes to make something great of our lives. Paper Renaissance.